नमः श्री यतिराजाय विवेकानंद सूरये सच्चित्सुखस्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापहारिणे। Today is a very auspicious day. The birthday of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, one of the greatest incarnations that were born on this soil. Today we shall delve a little into his life and his philosophy. Sri Ramakrishna used to talk a lot about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Nimai and Nithai. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his close attendant and follower Nithyananda. Nithai. They both used to dance in ecstasy and enjoy along with other devotees. Nithai was considered as incarnation of Balarama. And Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is considered as incarnation of Krishna. So very interesting life. He was born in 1486 and lived up to 1533. There were 47 years of life. What a phenomenal life. On 15th March, when we discussed Sri Ramakrishna, we discussed Sri Ramakrishna as a spiritual phenomenon. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also was a spiritual phenomenon. You can't consider spiritual luminaries of that stature as spiritual personalities. They were phenomenons. As Swamiji would say about Sri Ramakrishna, a great tidal wave came from that mighty ocean of consciousness. If you describe consciousness, that all-pervading spirit, God as an ocean, and from that ocean a mighty wave came in the form of Sri Ramakrishna to submerge, to deluge the entire world with spirituality. Sri Ramakrishna himself used to say, a Jivan Mukta, a self-realized soul, may at best can help two or three more people to cross this ocean of samsara. But if an incarnation comes, he would be like a Jain ship. He would carry hundreds and hundreds of people across the sea of samsara to the other shore. So that would be the difference. The ordinary Jivan Mukta is different and incarnation is different. Incarnation will come into the world with tremendous spiritual power. They would impart spirituality by mere look, by a word, or just with a touch. That would be the power of an incarnation. Sri Ramakrishna would draw the distinction clearly between an ordinary person, an ordinary individual who has become enlightened, and an incarnation who would come into the world to re-establish dharma. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was one such incarnation. With tremendous power he came into the world. So you have to remember this sloka from the Bhagavad Gita, you know. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati. Glani happens all the time. Why glani happens to dharma? There are two forces. One is the divine grace and another is maya. Both are from the Lord. We are in between. So the primary instinct of human beings is to get attracted towards maya. Because maya actually brings immediate satisfaction. But it is sense gratification, which is very little compared to the divine bliss that we can enjoy. But that divine bliss doesn't come just like that. So Buddha had attained Nirvana, but effort of so many births was there that culminated into the final Buddha. It doesn't happen just like that. You have to make a lot of effort. As the Upanishad says, Paranchikani Vetranasvayambhu Tasmat Paran Pashyati Antaratman. The Lord has designed the human being for the matter of all beings in such a way that the natural tendency of these beings is to look outward and to seek pleasures and happiness from outside. Kathopanishad says, Shreyascha Prehascha Manushyametaha. Shreyas and Prayas. Shreyas is that which brings good to us, and prayas is that is comfortable and pleasurable. Both things come to us. Only a man of discrimination, Vivinakti Dhiraha, discrimination, the man who has got that subtle intellect, he chooses the good to the exclusion of the pleasurable. But somebody who is dull-witted, somebody who is not that intelligent, he chooses the pleasurable to the exclusion of the good. Most of us actually will fall into the second category. We choose the pleasurable and we exclude the good one. We have to look whatever that comes into our life, we have to apply this definition. Will it bring good to me in the long run or not? In the short run, immediately, it may not be that palatable to us. It may be uncomfortable for us to follow, but better to choose that uncomfortable one. Because in the long run, it will give you eternal peace and happiness. But other thing actually, which is prayas, the Sanskrit word is prayas, which is pleasurable, immediately it brings joy. But in the long run, it turns out to be a nightmare. It leads to bondage. So because of this weakness in human beings, not that we are weak by birth, what empowers us, what strengthens us is this tapas. If you are not inclined towards tapas, what happens? You tend to become weak. So India actually is tapo bhumi, the land of penance. But today actually you don't hear this much, people saying that you do tapas and gain strength. Do penance and gain strength. Meditation gives you strength. Prayer gives you strength. Repetition of God's name gives you strength. It helps you to gain mastery over your indriya senses. With that powerful and controlled mind, actually it becomes easier for us to travel towards the truth. If we don't make any effort in that direction, the pull of the senses you cannot overcome. The senses will drag us, and sensory pleasures and sensory cravings will dominate our consciousness, and creature comforts will become the sole objective and purpose of life for the majority of the people. They think that is life. You enjoy for some time, then you will become old and one day you will die. This is life, that much the life has to offer. But our scriptures, they say, our sages have declared again and again that as we have come here as human beings, there is a possibility for all of us, that is to know the truth, to know our maker, to know the source of the universe. Why should we know the source of the universe? We have discussed that. We'll become immortal. That brings us eternal peace and eternal happiness. And peace and happiness, of returning to which actually there is nothing more to attain. You are totally fulfilled. You have become the absolute. You'll become all powerful. That is a blessed state and blessed existence. In Yoga Vashishta, there is a sloka, beautiful sloka. Rama asks Vashishta, Ato atucham anayasam anupadigata brahmam, kim tastiti padam sadho yatra shoko navidhyate. Atucham. Rama was telling that the present existence is tuccha, despicable. I don't want this existence. This is not that comfortable. It is fraught with so many limitations. So with the Vairagya Prakarna, Rama says actually the limitations of childhood, limitations of youth, limitations of old age. Life is full of limitations. There is not one stage of life where actually you can enjoy everything, where there is perfection. Childhood, you know, the suffering is there, one kind of suffering, some kind of suffering is always there at every stage of life. So is there any stage in life where there is no suffering can be had? Nothing of that sort. Not that Rama was a pessimistic person. He had the sharpest of the intellect. With that penetrating intellect, he could see that every stage of life in a way is limited. Some limitation actually is imposed. And so then he says, Atu atucham. The present existence is tuccha, is very despicable. I want that state, atucham, anayasam, which is not burdensome. Today life has become burdensome for many people, right? People are experiencing that burden of life. The Rama uses that beautiful language, anayasam. Anupadigata brahmam, which is free from upadis, which is free from adjuncts, which is free from limitations. Kim tat sthiti padam sadho. What is that state? Rama was shrewd enough, he was talking about state, pada. If it is actually form, it will be destroyed after some time, right? Anything that exists in time and space, by default, it has to decay and degenerate. It will die, it will disappear one day. Anything that is created must die one day, will get destroyed, because that is the law of nature. Anything that is in time and space will disappear one day, sooner or later. So that's why he was not talking about something, a form. He says there, pada, kim tat sthiti padam sadhu yatra shoko na vidyate, where no suffering can be had. You tell me about that state where no suffering can be had. The question, you see, what a profound question. He was asking me, take me, lead me to that state where no misery can be had, where I can be perfectly happy, where I can be eternally peaceful. So now, afterwards, you know the discussion the Vasishtha would be talking about consciousness all the time. So, here when Dharma declines, Lord incarnates again and again to show us the path of spirituality. India, as it is a spiritual land, Lord incarnated time and again to show us the path of spirituality. Because this is the only blessed land where spirituality is understood, spirituality is pursued. We have the mature understanding as to the ultimate objective and purpose of life. No other race on the planet can claim to have this objective. We have been a spiritual race all through. We never cared for this material prosperity. Why? Because life is too short. I can create wealth, but how long I will be able to enjoy? By the time you create wealth, you are in 40s and 50s. And next, how much life is left to enjoy? You will be off very soon from this world. So why to waste energies? Because when the life is so short and in that direction, is there something which can bring me permanent happiness, eternal peace? The quest actually has always been there. There was that period, Vedic period, where hundreds and hundreds of people pursued it with such determination and such intensity that they all had experienced the truth, and they gave us all that Vedas, mass of literature, so of spiritual wisdom, of highest wisdom, as to the purpose of human existence and the highest possibility for a human being. And we are all proud possessors of that spiritual inheritance now. But of course, as we see today, the circumstances are not that favorable for majority of the people, of course, because the samsara has become so troublesome. The responsibilities, every human being is preoccupied with so many things. But now if you look at this life of a saint, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he says, abandon everything to Lord's care. That's all. You have only one thing to do, that is cultivate love for God. Not a bhakti. He talks about prema. Krishna prema. You must love Krishna. That is the only objective, if you ask Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Okay, if you are a contemporary, if you had gone to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and asked for what is the purpose of life, he would say, love Krishna. That's all. Do I not have to think about other things, actually, how I have to provide for myself, the basic necessities of life, nothing. Everything he will arrange, he would say. Only you have to love Krishna, that's all, Krishna prema. Bhakti is also inferior. Bhakti is only to take you to that prema. Prema is higher than bhakti. So you all know, and Bhagavata talks about, this Sri Ramakrishna also, many times he mentions in the five kinds of bhava, with which we can relate ourselves to God. Shanta, Dasya, Sakya, Vasalya, and Madhura. So we can have a peaceful relationship with God, like kind of Kuchela had, right? Many devotees actually, they worship the Lord. They have a peaceful relationship with God. But the intensity is not there, but they love God. They remember God. Many examples are there. Most of the Pandavas actually had great cultivator, Shanta, Dasya. When you talk about Dasya Bhakti, we remember Hanuman. Okay, many devotees are there who consider themselves as servants of the Lord, Dasya Bhakti. I am Dasa, I am the servant of the Lord. All the time they would think actually, they consider themselves as Dasa, Ramadasa, Krishna Dasa, Ramadasa, that is my glory. I am the servant of the Lord. So that brings, you know, self-effacement, you know, ultimately as Swamiji says, you know, whether it is Karma Yoga or Bhakti Yoga or Jnana Yoga or Raja Yoga, the purpose of all these spiritual practices is to attain to that complete self-effacement, a self-abnegation, where there is no I, where there is no aham, there is nothing like I. When you remove that I, only God will remain. God is not there from somewhere outside. When you just attain to this annihilation of this lower ahankara or ego sense, you will be filled with God. Because today we are totally attached to the body. This is mine. This I am. So when you are that's attached to the body with that kind of intensity, you will not be able to experience God. So this identification with the body, we must let go. For that, all these spiritual sadhanas or practices are prescribed. So in Dasya Bhakti, a devotee who wants to cultivate Dasya Bhakti always considers himself as Dasa, a servant of Master. God becomes your master and you are his Dasa, your servant. And they take delight in that and they will get their reward ultimately. Ultimately the realization will come. But here, in bhakti practices, devotional practices, they actually make a distinction between these five states. Shanta is second, is first, second is Dasya, third is Sakya, where you consider yourself as a friend of God. Arjuna must have considered Krishna as his friend. Pandavas actually considered him a friend. Shanta Bhakti, and also you can practice 2-3 also. Sakya Bhakti also they practiced. A friend, God is my friend. The advantage is God is not a very powerful human being. If you consider him as a powerful being, and if you are conscious of his power all the time, the fear comes. You cannot really relate to yourself, right? Friendship happens only between equals, right? God is very powerful, I am very small. Can the relationship happen? Friendship? A poor man and a rich man, can they be friends? Rarely. Okay? Friendship happens between equals only. Only when you consider God as your equal, okay, you can develop the Sakya Bhakti. No, you are always conscious of God's all-powerful glory, all-powerful nature. Now God has created this universe, he's so powerful. If you're conscious of that, you'll always fear him, right? A sense of awe will overpower you. You will not go near him. You can't really develop and establish a relationship. That is a disadvantage if you're conscious of God's actually all-powerful nature. The Sakya Bhakti, where you consider God as your comrade, your friend, is good. But all the time you are thinking about your friend. We think actually some good friend is the bosom friend. All the time you think about your friend and his welfare, right? Day and night. Not an ordinary friend, a bosom friend. A good friend of yours, day and night. You are ready to sacrifice your everything for the sake of your friend. And you have to develop that kind of relationship for God. He's your friend and you are ready to sacrifice everything for his sake. And to help him, to serve him actually is one objective of your life. Day and night you think about his welfare. And you have attained your objective. You have made God as your friend, and day and night you think about your friend's welfare. As you are thinking about God, ultimately the purpose of life is achieved. The purpose of life is to focus mind on God. And through this Sakya relationship, through friendship, considering God as a comrade, you have succeeded in filling your mind totally with the thought of God. After all, you have chosen him as your friend. So by cultivating this relationship also, you can attain to the supreme beatitude, oneness with God. Then Vatsalya, where actually you consider God actually as your child. The kind of love Mother Yashodhara cultivated towards Krishna. Nanda cultivated this love towards Krishna. Yashodhara never, she was not conscious of, so Krishna had shown so many miracles. She was not conscious of actually Krishna's glory in that sense. Krishna's actually our powerful nature. Any number of miracles he had shown, but she would forget all of them. My child, my child, my child. Krishna had so many things he had shown, but she would consider him my child. So this is Vatsalya. Just as a child has its needs all the time, you know. You have to feed the child, you have to clothe the child, you have to give birth to the child. Child is totally dependent upon its mother. In the same way, you think actually the Lord is totally dependent on me. Not you are dependent on the Lord. Lord is totally dependent on me. Vatsalya Bhakti. Now whether you are a man or woman also you can cultivate, doesn't matter. No, but I'm a man, how can I consider? Yashoda actually was a woman, so she could cultivate that motherly love. You can cultivate fatherly love, what does it matter? It doesn't matter. Child depends on father also. And all the time you consider yourself as father, and God actually as your child. And day and night think about your child, because child needs your support, child needs your care, child needs your attention. With that is called Vatsalya Bhakti. You can attain to God. The final is the Madhura Bhakti. Madhura Bhakti is actually love of a woman for a man, or a man towards a woman, it could be also. And here in Bhagavata we have this love of gopis for Krishna. That is actually illicit love. Most of the gopis were already married. They had their husbands and children, but they loved Krishna. So this illicit love, conjugal love, actually it has the most power. See, the nature of the human mind is such, however hard, you may say that actually, don't go in that direction, but it will go there only. There it has a tendency. It has a tendency to go towards the wrong. You say no, you don't go there, but it will go there only. When that impulse which we have, today we see so many incidents happening in the society, that also you can turn towards the Lord. These gopis, they developed that kind of love for Krishna, and that helped them actually to think about Krishna day and night, and through that conjugal love they had attained to the supreme beatitude. Bhagavata, this is, but Vivekananda says that it is not possible for ordinary people and it should not be preached widely and extensively. That Chaitanya Mahaprabhu preached this love, Krishna Prema, this conjugal love, as the highest form of love that you can exhibit towards the Lord. But you need to understand this, anybody can cultivate this, you need not be a woman for that. You know, once Mirabai went to Vrindavan, and there actually she wanted to meet this great devotee, disciple of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Jiva Goswami and Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami. And they refused to meet her because she was a woman. Because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had strictly instructed his disciples and not to mix much with the individuals of opposite sex. They had the highest degree of renunciation. Okay? They practice highest degree of renunciation, and they practice at the same time this conjugal love towards the Lord. And then Mirabai sent an message saying that in Vrindavan there is only one male, that was Krishna. All others are women. In fact, that was what they were practicing, but still they couldn't understand. There's only one man, that was Krishna. Everybody else was female. That means what? You have to cultivate that conjugal love towards Krishna. You may be a man, but you must cultivate that love. Consider yourself as a woman and then love Krishna as your husband. And then all that Mahabhava, that which actually Mirabai had experienced, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had experienced, the gopis experienced, it would be possible. But that's the highest form of love. The Shanta, the Dasya, Sakya, Vatsalya, they are actually inferior compared to this Madhura Bhava. Because Madhura Bhava is so potent and so powerful, and it will take you directly to the Lord, and it's actually the highest experience of bliss can be had through this. Gopis were experiencing that. Total sense of abandonment, no sense of guilt, no feeling of, you know, doing a wrong thing, no social customs. The husbands actually tried to stop them, the relatives tried to stop it, the children tried to stop, but the gopis were, you know, got attracted towards Krishna irresistibly. Only thought of Krishna, they became mad. They went and ran towards him as soon as they heard the flute with a frenzy, and they went and danced with him, because they meditated and thought only of Krishna and ultimately attained to Krishna consciousness. Krishna was not there with them for too long. He had just made them taste the bliss of this conjugal love and left Vrindavan. First he went to Mathura, and from there to Hastinapur and to Dwaraka. It disappeared, but they never forgot Krishna in their entire life, till their last breath. They just thought day and night, whatever they would do, a bee will hum and that they think actually Jesus is Krishna's messenger. A bird will coo and they think that Krishna's messenger has come. Anything that they see in this creation, they saw it as symbol of God, Krishna. That was actually the kind of Krishna consciousness they had attained to. And they were blessed souls for that matter, and all of them had attained to Mahabhava. And Sri Ramakrishna would say, if you ask for liberation, God will actually grant you liberation, but he will not give you this Mahabhava. Therefore, that he will become your slave. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had preached this extraordinary, you know, love, conjugal love towards the Lord actually is the highest relationship that we can establish. Of course, Swamiji says that it's not practicable and it should not be preached extensively. The people misunderstand it and so they might get degraded also. That happened actually after Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He insisted on renunciation. Vivekananda says, what is this idea of bhakti without renunciation? Most pernicious. And the people who actually claimed themselves to be the followers of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu afterwards, they brought all kinds of things, men and women intermixed freely and it degenerated. Naturally, it would happen. But it requires highest degree of renunciation and purity to cultivate this form of love towards Krishna. There is no trace of lust there. There is no trace of kama. It's the purest form of love. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had shown a lot of miracles in childhood actually, just like child Krishna. Just like child Krishna, he was very, very mischievous and very naughty, but very cute, very comely looking boy, and the people of Navadvip loved him all. And he had shown this divine ecstasy even when he was a boy. And people understood that actually this is a special manifestation of the divine, it's not an ordinary human being. So, his father was actually Jagannath Mishra and mother actually Sachi Devi. The father passed away very early in life when he was just a boy. And he had a brother by name Vishveshwar. So he was the 10th child. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was the 10th child. His brother actually the 9th child. First 8 actually were girls. They all died in their infancy. And probably Sachi Devi must have prayed intensely for the Lord actually to give a child actually who would live long. And then actually she had this Vishveshwar. But Vishveshwar developed deep passion. At the age of 16 he left home and he became an ascetic, he became a sannyasin. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was 10th child. And so he was a precocious child, extraordinary intelligence he was born with. Anything he would grasp and learn in no time, just like Shankaracharya. He was incarnation, born with supreme power. By 16 actually he started a Sanskrit school. He became a professor, started teaching Sanskrit and scriptures. You know, in those days, this Nadia district and Navadvip was famous for Navya Nyaya, a school of philosophy, Nyaya, you know, Nyaya Vaisheshika. We have these 6 systems of philosophy, you know, Purva Mimamsa, Nyaya, Vaisheshika, Sankhya, Yoga and Uttara Mimamsa. They are called Shad Darsanas, are the 6 systems of Indian philosophy. And so this Nadia district, this Navadvip actually, was famous for this Nyaya school of philosophy, Nyaya school of thought. Great pandits were there, scholars who were masters in the Nyaya philosophy. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also actually got exposed to that and he learned, he became a great scholar. He would enter into debates and discussions and he would defeat them. He would humble them in no time because he had that razor sharp intellect. And so nobody would win him, you know, against him in an argument. So he and one Raghunatha, they both were actually disciples of one Gangadas. They were taking the lessons in Nyaya from Gangadas. One day, their master asked them a subtle point in that Nyaya philosophy and wanted an answer from Raghunatha. Then he took the whole day, he just deliberated, thought and thought, scratched his brains, and he came with the answer only in the evening. It took him some 7-8 hours actually to find out the answer. And then the same question he had asked Chaitanya separately, and Chaitanya in a flash he had given the answer. By this time he was Nimai, he had not become Chaitanya Mahaprabhu yet, he was Nimai. The name that he had been given was actually Vishwambar. The father had given him the name Vishwambar. The mother actually gave him the name Nimai. Nimai actually name, you know, you give the negative name, you know, bitter. Bitter means that because many girls passed away and she had given him the name Nimai. And at the time of investiture, sacred thread ceremony, he was given the name Gauranga. Because his body complexion was golden And people, you know, they would look at him in amazement. He was body complexion is just like molten gold, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's. Later on, actually, he himself told that that was because he was meditating on Radha. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is considered as the incarnation of Krishna and Radha together in one personality. In the beginning phase of his life, actually, he had exhibited that Krishna consciousness. In the beginning, actually, he showed miracles, actually. He showed people that he was God himself, God incarnate, and people could recognize and started worshipping him. And afterwards, he had gone to Gaya and sudden transformation came upon him. Complete change of attitude. Now, actually, he started manifesting the Radha Bhava. That pain of viraha, you know, separation. Radha would feel that separation, you know. When she was, when Krishna was away from her and the viraha, the separation that they would experience. So now actually Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also wanted to taste that bliss which Radha had tasted. The bliss actually came from Krishna, but the Krishna did not experience that bliss, but it was Radha who had experienced the bliss. And in this incarnation, he wanted to experience, taste his own bliss. So like that Radha, actually he wanted to cultivate love for Krishna and wanted to taste that bliss. That's why actually it was Krishna and Radha in one incarnation. And he himself said, this golden complexion is not mine, because as I meditate on the heart of Radha and her visions and her imagination of Krishna, I got this golden complexion. That's what actually Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said. So as a child, when he was just a boy, one day he had asked his mother, suddenly, you know, very petulant and very obstinate child. There were two devotees, Jagadish and Hiranya. They were great devotees of Krishna. They would offer a lot of naivedya, a lot of food they make in their home, and they used to offer to Krishna in their shrine. And one day suddenly he had expressed the desire that I want to eat that prasad, I want to eat that naivedya. So they had cooked and they were about to offer it to Krishna. And then this boy actually started pestering his mother, I wanted to eat that, I wanted to eat that only. So Mother Sachi Devi had gone and told the Jagadish and Hiranya, and then they came with the naivedya. And they saw Bala Gopala in him, and they offered it to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu when he was as Nimai. And then actually he had taken all that prasada, he had consumed all that. So he had exhibited these powers, he showed that he was none other than Krishna to people. There was one scholar by name Murari Gupta. He used to expound the Yoga Vashishta. He used to expound Yoga Vashishta to people, and as part of that discourse, he used to tell them, actually, we are all one with consciousness, we are all one with God. You know, Yoga Vashishta is basically an Advaita text. Everywhere, God everywhere is there, and the whole universe is part of Him. The whole universe exists in Him, and every individual, every creature for that matter, actually, is part of that consciousness, is one with God and one with Divine. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu remonstrated with him, because he was a very, you know, obstinate and very mischievous child. And he said, what kind of child you are one day? Then he said, Akhil, I will teach you a lesson. By evening, then what he had defiled his food. He had defiled his food, and but he could not take that. Now he said, now I see Advaita, where is Advaita has gone? So don't preach this Advaita that you are one with God. Cultivate love for Krishna. Having come here as a Jiva in an embodiment, actually, the best thing for Jivas will be is to cultivate love for Krishna. That will actually help them to attain moksha. But with this kind of attachment to the body, with this kind of identification with the senses, and if you say that I am Krishna, then no, it doesn't get actually really connected. It doesn't make sense. Who should say that I am one with the Brahman? Aham Brahmasmi, you know, it's actually Upanishadic dictum. I am Brahmasmi. That who should say that Aham Brahmasmi? After experiencing the truth, after experiencing consciousness, Vivekananda could say, Krishna could say, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa could say, Aham Brahmasmi. But we Jivas who are in ignorance, if we say Aham Brahmasmi, one body becomes Brahman, but body is not Brahman. You have not experienced your soul, you have not experienced your consciousness, you have not experienced your spiritual nature. How can you declare yourself as God? So, this Advaita, and of course Shankaracharya himself said that Adhikaravada, who is fit to receive this Advaita Vedanta, but over a period of time now everybody gets to hear that God is all pervading, God is everywhere, that I am essentially Brahman. You are essentially Brahman, in truth actually, in reality we are God. That consciousness alone is real in us. But we have such identification with the body and mind, and we just want to enjoy everything of this world only through body and mind, then we see differentiation and duality and Bheda Drushti. Actually, is there with all of us. Where is Advaita? Advaita is a state. We are very far from that. So to attain to that Krishna Prema, cultivating love for Krishna actually is the best sadhana. That's what actually Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted to teach. And so he says to Murari Gupta, actually, what you are preaching actually is not right. Why it's not right? The people to whom you are preaching this, they are not the adhikaris. They are not the fit persons to receive this highest Advaita. that which actually they cannot practice in their lives, you should not preach, it's a waste of time. So he says that you cultivate love for Krishna. There was one fellow student, both of them actually were studying under that Gangadas. His name actually Raghunath Das. That Raghunath wanted to write a book on Nyaya. And in fact, this is Guru Ganga Das actually asked him to write a book, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually, Nimaya also started writing the book. And when he came to know that Raghunath Das, that Nimaya also was going to write a book on, on logic and Nyaya, he was sure that actually his text actually would not be considered by anybody, because he had understood the genius of Nimaya. And if he writes a book, nobody will read my book. So when they were actually in the same boat traveling, actually going towards their guru's home, and he had expressed this, he became morose. They asked one question to Nimaya, and Nimaya actually immediately told the answer. So if Nimaya writes a book, nobody will read my book. So he expressed his anguish and pain, and he became morose. Then what Nimaya did, he immediately threw the Nyaya book actually he was about to write. He had written few pages, he immediately threw it in Ganges, and he said that you write, actually I don't want to write anything actually. So what he said is, I don't want to get in competition with you. So this kind of love, this kind of kindness, and this kind of, humanistic consideration he had displayed very early in life. And afterwards actually he was married to one woman by name Lakshmi, and later on she died of snake bite. And he was married again to Vishnupriya. The father passed away, and brother actually had gone and became an ascetic. And only now mother and his wife Lakshmi. So he had shown his divine form to one devotee by name actually Srivas. One day actually this devotee, Vaishnava devotee, was worshipping Krishna in his home, in his puja mandira, altar. There was an altar actually where actually Lord would sit. He would make the Lord sit on that. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually went and knocked his door. And he opened the door and went and straight and sat on that altar. And actually, I am that whom you are worshipping. And the Srivas was taken aback. How can that be? I am that actually whom you are worshipping actually. So he did not believe in that. Then actually Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually showed him his true form, to him. And he said, I wanted to take bath. Then he provided water. And when he was taking water, he saw actually the light of actually 1,000 flashes. The light of 1,000 flashes actually he could see. The water actually appeared so bright, and so much of luminosity he could see all around. Then Srivas was convinced that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the Nimaya, was none other than the reincarnation of God actually. The people in India actually, when the incarnation comes, because we read so much of scriptures, in the beginning actually we doubt them, and Sri Ramakrishna was considered a mad person. And also many scholars of the time, contemporary period, they thought actually they are all actually hallucinations of the person. They thought actually it's mere sentimentality. So he had lost control, lost balance over his mind. But afterwards they could find and they could detect that they are not actually hallucinations of the mind. They are not actually mere sentimentalism. The genuine and substantial spiritual experience, because he would show the power also now and then. Through a mere touch actually he would take others, he would transport them actually to the prema bhakti. They would just dance in ecstasy and joy. Just one touch, they also would sing Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. So there came a point of time in his life, he went to Gaya, and then a great transformation came. He just all these discussions and debates and polemics, arguments with scholars, all that he dropped, and suddenly transformed himself into a great devotee of Krishna, and he wanted to practice that Radha's love towards Krishna. That's all. Sudden transformation came. A great scholar transformed into a great bhakta all of a sudden. And there was one Advaita Acharya, Vaishnava Acharya. In fact, he had prayed to Lord. It was his prayer actually that got, that brought Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu into this world. Where there was so much of decadence around. The Vaishnavas were practicing a religion, but there was a lot of contamination, a lot of evil practices had entered into the true bhakti towards Krishna. True renunciation was not there. They were offering all kinds of food. They were taking to drinking also, because this Vamachara, this Tantra, everything got mixed up, and it was total degradation all around. And a genuine devotee of God like Advaita Acharya felt sad at this, and then he prayed sincerely to the Divine, O Lord, you alone actually can bring these people back to Dharma. You alone actually can redeem these souls, because they have become so low. And then the Lord had come and was born in that family of Jagannath Mishra and Sachi Devi to redeem these people. So there was a scholar by name actually Keshava. He considered himself as a great scholar. He would enter into debates and discussions and defeat everybody. And he came to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Nimai at the time, and he wanted to pick up an argument with him. And then Chaitanya told, actually, then you compose a poem on Mother Ganges. He had composed 100 poems verbatim, just extempore composed. And then Chaitanya actually found out actually grammatical mistakes in his poems. And then he humbled his pride. And then he prostrated before Chaitanya. And in that night, the same night, he had a dream. He had a vision in which actually Mother Saraswati showed Nimai as actually a Krishna himself. So this Keshav, then he understood that he was not defeated by an ordinary scholar actually. Lord himself at this time incarnated in the form of this Nimai. So there are so many such incidents, extraordinary incidents. Tapasyananji Maharaj's book is there, Sri Chaitanya, His Life, Religion and Philosophy. The Life, Teachings and Philosophy, a beautiful work. A beautiful work. Whoever is interested in theology and what is actually this philosophy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It is called Achintya Beda Beda. You know, this is a technical term. Achintya Beda Beda. This love of Radha's love towards Krishna. And they are not pure Advaitins. This is not Advaita. Swamiji also said actually, as soon as we utter the word Vedanta in our culture, only Advaita Vedanta comes into mind. So Advaita actually is one of the Vedanta schools. What Ramanuja preached and what Madhvacharya preached, what Vallabhacharya preached, what Nimbarka preached, there are other schools of Vedanta. They are all actually bhakti schools, but they are all part of Vedantic schools only. If you read Bhagavad Gita, which is actually the authoritative text on the Upanishads, in the sense that the best commentary on the Upanishads, but you don't find only Advaita slokas, you will find Dvaita and Vishishtadvaita slokas also. Okay? So these systems are not contradictory to each other actually. Advaita is the culmination, Advaita is the acme, Advaita is the zenith, but actually it cannot be the, you know, the sadhana practice. We are all Vishishtadvaitins, we are all Dvaitins. We practice sadhana and ultimately we reach to that homogeneous existence, which is actually state, that is Nirvana, that is Kaivalya. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he did not encourage people to enter into this polemics thereafter, and he said that all this is dry. Constantly thinking about what is the nature of God, what you will achieve by using the intellect. Anyway, intellect will not take you towards God. It is not possible. Reason it only will go up to this, and afterwards actually, that urge, that soul's urge, genuine urge for God's vision. If you don't get a drop of it, a trace of it actually, life becomes barren, life becomes dry. So he just dropped all the scholarship, all these discussions and debates, and then he advocated only Krishna Prema. And he was initiated by one Ishwar Puri into this mantra. And I think, I don't know the mantra, the English meaning is actually, I salute that Lord actually who is Gopi Vallabha. Okay, Gopi Vallabha, who is the Lord of Gopis. And thereafter actually he started reciting that. And because now actually he is married, his mother is there, he is taking care. And he was experiencing all these divine visions, but the pandits of this Nadia districts, they did not fully actually accept his divinity as yet, because you know, human beings, as human beings we have this reason. Even if Lord comes in front of us, incarnates in human form and exhibits all this, we don't actually, first we suspect, we doubt actually. It takes time for us actually to understand this is a divinity, this is not an ordinary human being. So they were still skeptical about his visions and his experiences and his devotional outbursts. And so now Nimai thought to take sannyasa. So I have to demonstrate through my life that only through renunciation you can have the highest bhakti. And he wanted to take sannyasa. Now he is married already. Second wife, Vishnupriya, and mother is there. She is old, about 50 years probably. Yeah. And so he asked for approval from mother. The mother naturally, no mother would allow his son to become a sannyasin. And wife also. Now actually after marriage, if you want to take sannyasa, you have to take the permission of your wife also. So with great difficulty, you know, he could convince them. It was great difficulty. What arguments he put forward, we don't know. But the mother actually, she had given her consent, most unwillingly, both wife and mother. And so he wanted to take a sannyasa from one Keshav Bharati. One night actually, he just came out of the house, he swam across the river Ganges and then actually crosses. At the place is there in Kanba, and there he goes. And requests him actually to initiate him into sannyasa. And that Keshav Bharati refuses to initiate him. And say, I need your permission of your mother and permission of your wife. You are just a young man, of handsome young man of 25-year-old. And then again, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Nimai actually insisted that I want to take sannyasa for this reason, please initiate me. The Keshav Bharati refused, saying that you have such love for Krishna, I am inferior to you, how can I initiate you into sannyasa? But it doesn't matter actually, just a formality, just you do it for me. And so then some argument went on, and ultimately he had initiated him and named him Krishna Chaitanya. Krishna Chaitanya name was given to him by that Keshava Bharati, who had initiated into sannyasa. His original name actually is Nimai. Now the Nimai became Krishna Chaitanya. So afterwards actually he came back and he had expressed his desire to go to Vrindavan. But now that Radha mood actually was overpowering him all the time. Radha would long to see Krishna, right? Day and night, one object of Radha was to merge in Krishna, to see Krishna. And for that actually he wanted to go to Vrindavan. And again he requested his mother. One day actually he just left the home and he just 5 kilometers. He just went 5 kilometers towards west, thinking that he would reach Vrindavan. Then by then as his disciple, one Nithyananda, who is actually Nithai, he had a vision. He saw actually 6-armed divinity in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He saw the 6-armed divinity. In 2 arms actually he had seen bow and arrows, Rama, and another 2 arms actually he was playing flute, Krishna, and then he had seen the sannyasi with a kamandalu and staff, one hand kamandalu and another hand staff. So after seeing that, he was thoroughly convinced that actually this is an incarnation, and that Nithyananda became a great disciple of Nimai, Krishna Chaitanya, and he was there with him throughout his life. And so he had gone much before he could go, and then he saw a few cowboys. A sannyasin by name actually Krishna Chaitanya would come in this direction. He would ask the way, a route to Vrindavan. Please misguide him, please misdirect him and show him the way towards Ganga. And then that's how he comes back, not to his house, and Shantipur actually, where the home of Advaita Acharya, with whom actually he had some discussions before. He goes there, he stayed there for 10 days. Then his mother also goes there. She saw now sannyasin, that boy turned into, Nimai turned into Krishna Chaitanya sannyasin. And then he touched his mother, and mother also went into bhava, and she also went into ecstasy. Afterwards, he wants permission of his mother to go to Vrindavan, but she refuses to give permission to him to go to Vrindavan. But now this Radha Bhava was actually overpowering him. He wanted to see Krishna and wanted to go to Vrindavan. Day and night, only one thought, I must go to Vrindavan and I must see my Krishna. Because now Radha Bhava, full of Radha Bhava. So his mother did not give him permission, and she said that you go to Puri. There the Lord is there, Jagannath, and you reside there, because Puri is not very far. Vrindavan is 2000 miles from here, from Navadvip. So if you are in Puri actually now and then, I would get to hear about you and I can also come, you can also come. And ultimately, to satisfy his mother, instead of going to Vrindavan, he comes to Puri. Yes, he saw the dome of the temple of Puri from a distance of 6 miles, and he went into ecstasy. And he said that Krishna is beckoning me, Krishna is calling me, my Krishna is calling me. That was sufficient, you know. He was full of that Mahabhava, of Radha Bhava, the dome itself, the temple dome of Jagannath, temple in Puri. And then he went into ecstasy. And for the 6 miles with great difficulty, he could walk. And as soon as he entered into the temple, he wanted to embrace the image of Jagannath. He wanted to rush. And he rushed, in fact. He rushed, actually. On the way, he just fell down. The temple guards saw this and they wanted to assault him. Because it's an intruder suddenly, they would not allow you to touch the image. And then actually one tall Brahmana gentleman by name Vasudeva Sarvabhauma, he intervened and he stopped. He was actually from Navadvip. When Krishna Chaitanya was a Nimai, he had gone to him to learn little Nyaya. He was his disciple also. Afterwards actually from Navadvip he came to Puri and settled over there, this Vasudeva Sarvabhauma. He was admired, he was respected a lot by temple priests, temple gods and the entire town of Puri as a great scholar. He was the head of all the scholars' team. So this Vasudeva Sarvabhauma, he saw this bright sannyasin of 25-year-old and he saw this is not an ordinary man, but definitely must be an individual of great spiritual worth. He stopped the guards and then actually he provided accommodation in his house to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his companions. Some 4 or 5 companions, 4 or 5 disciples are also there with him, and he provided accommodation to him. And he had entered into an argument with this Vasudeva Sarvabhauma. He was a great scholar. He did not believe in all these experiences. They thought actually they are hallucinations of the person, because he was given more to reason and logic. He would read more of Shankaracharya and his commentaries and Vedanta, you know it. And all this had happened. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, one day they were discussing a topic of Bhagavatam. And he had given some interpretation to that sloka, this Vasudeva Sarvabhauma. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had given a better interpretation. And when he saw the logic and cogency with which he could put forward his understanding, then the Sarvabhauma understood that he is also a scholar of, you know, a great reputation and a scholar of great caliber. And afterwards, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu showed his divine form to him, that six-armed divine form, which he had shown previously to some people. He had shown this to Vasudeva Sarvabhauma, and then he went into ecstasy. He was very fortunate, that scholar was very fortunate, because he wanted to transform him from a dry scholar who would discuss and debate about Vedanta all the time into a great devotee of Lord Krishna. And for Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, now actually teaching Krishna love alone is the sole objective of life. Hearts have become dry. People want a drop of happiness. They will not get this happiness through sensory pleasures, or they will not get this kind of happiness even by reading scriptures. You may be a great pandit, you may be great scholars, you might have by hearted so many scriptures, but that's all memory. There's a load of information in your brain, but that doesn't give you actually even little of happiness. All that load of information, today computer stores a lot of information, right? So all that slokas, they would by heart and they will have it in their head. Why? How does it bring you happiness if you don't cultivate your emotion, if you don't cultivate love for Krishna? Life actually is dry. For those scholars also, most of the time they experience the dryness. But somehow actually they will get some respect in the society, because I'm a great scholar. People consider you, people venerate you, because you're such a learned man. And then that is sufficient for them. I have got so much of respect because of my scholarship. But that doesn't really satisfy you or make you happy from within. Are you really happy from within? People may be respecting you, right? Today there are so many rich people. They are happy. Are they happy from within? People may be respecting you. People may be considering them as successful people in the world, as people of great accomplishments. But are you really happy from within? That happiness comes only when you cultivate love for Krishna, when you cultivate devotion to the lotus feet of the Lord. So he transformed that Vasudeva Sarvabhauma, then Vasudeva Sarvabhauma also becomes a disciple, then actually he made a pilgrimage to south in those days, you know. All these great people, you know, from the very beginning, from Rama onwards. Rama also, before he went with Vishwamitra as his disciple, he travelled across the length and breadth of the Bharatavarsha. There this land actually is full of spirituality. So many temples, no other country in the world has these many temples and this much of spiritual fervor and vibration. North to south you go, where how many temples, how much we have invested in spirituality over the years, over the centuries, how many sages and saints we have produced. Their thoughts still permeate this cosmos. So it's, if you are just there in India, you are spiritual. But today we are trying to kill that spiritual instinct. Okay? Any temple you go to, ancient temples, you just go and spend some time there, and that spiritual vibration will penetrate into your being, and actually you will be transported to your new realm. But today actually we miss that focus, because most of the temples have become places of, you know, commercial activity, and government also is interested in revenue. This is an unfortunate state of development. But still you feel, any ancient temple you go. So he went and visited many places, and 52 pilgrimage places he had visited, only with one companion, that was Krishna Das. Many interesting experiences he had. He meets one Ramananda Roy near Rajamundry. And in fact, this Vasudeva Sarvabhauma asked him to meet the Ramananda Roy. He had a long discussion with Ramananda Roy. And for this Ramananda Roy, actually, he blessed with the Radha Krishna form of his. For others, actually, he had shown this Rama and Krishna form. But for this Ramananda Roy, he had shown his Radha Krishna form. And this Ramananda Roy is overwhelmed with this kind of vision. And afterwards, he asked this Ramananda Roy, "You please go to Puri." He was governor here, governor of that Prataparudra, Orissa ruler. And he asked him actually to go to Puri. There we shall talk about Krishna and spend rest of our life only in the thought of Krishna. So after pilgrimage, he came back to Puri and settled there. And he lived 13 years more, constantly thinking about Krishna and dancing. When there was that Ratha Yatra, he would dance in front of the Ratha. And people would see the dance, ecstatic dance. He would roll on the ground, rub his head to the ground. Because that is Mahabhava. Sri Ramakrishna would tell that actually, that Mahabhava, when overpowers you, you will lose all the sense of shame, all the sense of what the people will think about you, what they talk about you, whether what they are seeing, is it appropriate to do all these things, everything. No. You are not in this world, you are just as this material world is real for us, for such great devotees of the Lord, only the realm of the spirituality alone is real, and this world of name and form is totally unreal. So that was the level of Krishna consciousness Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had manifested. In fact, he was none other than Krishna. Krishna reincarnated, Krishna had incarnated, he came in the form of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to bless this land, already blessed land. And Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa had not an iota of doubt to declare and to say that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was a great incarnation of Lord Krishna. Very inspirational biography. Just to share a few thoughts with you, I read it today. Otherwise, I might not have read it. But it gave me great inspiration. And thanks actually for giving me the opportunity to read Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, because I could share a few thoughts with you. So such biographies will elevate our soul, will elevate our spirit. Definitely, it will create an indelible impression in your mind. So, because the small biography is available, Tapasyanja book, if you have time, please, inclination, and please read that. Otherwise, you can just search in the net. So, one beautiful things are available about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. A great festival, the Dol Purnima in Bengal, Orissa and Assam. Today, actually, the great festival is going on. And International Society for Krishna Consciousness for ISKCON people, actually, is a great festival. In Mayapur, actually, where actually he was born, Navadvip, their headquarters, international headquarters there. So today, actually, they offer, they do this Abhisheka. Abhisheka with honey, Abhisheka with ghee, Abhisheka with milk, and Abhisheka with flowers, Abhisheka with fruits to that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his image at Mayapur. And with great gaiety and eclat and solemnity, they perform the birthday of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, please read actually, it's a very powerful biography. He did not write anything on his own. His disciples, that Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami, they established the philosophy, because he was too full of God to write anything. Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa himself did not write anything, right? He always would talk about God and would get into ecstasy and bhava. Where was mind? The mind itself was not there. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was also like that. No time to write anything, because his mind would merge into Supreme Consciousness, absolute, super consciousness, effortlessly. And so his disciples actually jotted down and they wrote the philosophy. This is Achintya Veda Bheda, the philosophy's name is. It doesn't matter what philosophy it is, ultimately what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's message is, cultivate love for Krishna. That is the best spiritual sadhana for this yuga, for this Kali age. We shall stop here, but it's no time. Let us meditate just for 1 minute before we disperse.
Ooh.